You can just call me Andrew T. I'm a lead developer of the Banana projects, you know, which you all probably know. It's an open source project for visualizing data inside Solr. Okay. There's a lot of people, you know, ask me a question, you know, why we name it Banana. Anybody know the answer? Okay. Yeah, I guess nobody know the answer except me. Okay. Because because one day, right, when I started working for Lucidworks, and we need to find some of the tools to help us make life easier for the user of the Solr, you know. So I'm looking around, okay, on the open source project, and I found Kibana project, okay. But Kibana project, the problem is that it's not really, you know, used for Solr data. So I fork it and make it, you know, work with Solr data specifically, and, you know, trying to add more feature to it, right? And then I asked my manager, you know, after I done some work, you know, with the fork, right, we need to give it some name. And they say, okay, what should we name it, you know? And he couldn't give me an answer, so I say, why not we name it Banana, you know, because I think it's kind of funny, and it's rhymed with Kibana. And that's how it gets started, right? And luckily nobody, you know, opposed me. So I took the liberty and just, you know, upload it, you know, push the code to GitHub, and that's it. That's the history. Okay. So how many of you have been downloading and using Banana dashboard already? Oh, okay. Maybe about half of them. Okay. So in this talk, right, I will try to go through the basic of setting up the Banana. Okay, what is the components that make it work together? And then at the end, which is the main goal, is that I will try to show you, you know, how easy it is for you to create your own custom panel that, you know, gonna work specifically for your own work, okay? Sorry, okay. Okay, here's a component, okay. In most of the deployment, okay, that I have been worked with, you know, in a POC or prospect, right, most of them, one, they use Banana dashboard for visualizing log data. Okay, a few of them actually want to try to use it with a non-time series data, you know, like kind of like a full text search when you go to the e-commerce website. Okay, but in general, what you have is you're gonna have to have the input layer. You know, that can be Logstash, Flume, you know, anything that you already used in your infrastructure. Okay, and you wanna feed it into Solr, which in this case gonna act kind of like NoSQL database. You know, you can think of it that way. But it's better because, you know, you can have a search capability, you know, out of the box, right, with Solr. And then Banana will be the last layer, which is for presentation, you know, make it easier for your user, especially for the business user, to be able to do some data exploration with your data, you know, visually, you know, without having to type in the query command, you know. So there are two main way that you can deploy Banana. For developer, you know, it's probably easiest if you put it on one single host, you know, or in one node, okay? So if you already download Banana, you can tell that, you know, it's just a client-side server. No, sorry. It's just a client-side code which contain HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, right? So it's all run in your web browser. So you just download the whole directory of Banana and put it in either in the Jetty container, you know, which already comes with the Solr, or, you know, Tomcat, you know, Apache web server, anything. Okay, and you just point your web browser to the Banana index.html, and then it just run. Okay, and then you just configure the Banana dashboard, okay, to point to your Solr instance at the specific collection that you want to visualize your data, and then it just work. Okay, then, you know, the rest you just customize your panel, you know, if you want to have like a time pickers, you want to have a bar charts, pie charts, you know, table panel, you know, anything, okay? But in the real production, you probably want to go with the second deployment layout, okay, which is you install Banana in like a multiple hosts, right? In this case, okay, you're gonna have this could be Solr, you know, single node, or can be a Solr cloud, right? If you use a Solr cloud, you're gonna have to configure Banana to point to your zookeeper, which is gonna distribute or redirect, you know, routing your request to the right Solr cloud node. Okay, but then and then you might actually run into a problem with the cost issue. Okay, because it's related to the, you know, security that built in with the modern web browser. Okay, when you try to do make a request from banana dashboard, right, from one host to another host in web browser, that is considered a cross domain. Okay, and sometimes it, actually not sometimes, but you know, all the time it's gonna block your request. So that's why when you download banana into your laptop, okay, you open up a web browser and you try to query against Solr, you know, externals instead of Solr, and then, you know, an error comes up, and that's the reason why. Okay, so there is a way that you can fix it, okay? And I put the direction in here, okay, so you can go to this GitHub, okay, page and read the instruction on how to enable cost request in Solr, okay? But if you use a different container that is not the Jetty that comes with Solr, then, you know, you have to look at the documentation on the related product or server that you use. So now we're gonna take a look at, you know, how you can build your own custom panel and add it to your own dashboard. Okay. So before that, I'd like to go over the basic of the, you know, technology, you know, behind Banana. Okay. If you are familiar with Kibana, you probably, you know, can tell that, you know, all the dashboard is actually a JSON file, okay, sitting in your disk. Okay. On your client side, you know, laptop browser. So to build a dashboard, right, you can see that that's just a JSON object with different kind of properties, okay? And in each properties, right, the main thing is rows. So depending on how many rows you have on the dashboard, right, in this case, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So you're gonna have an array of 4 elements, you know, and each array gonna define, you know, what each row gonna look like on your dashboard. Okay. Next, you're gonna have a panel containing in each row. You can think of it like a column. Okay. So for the first row, you're gonna have 1, 2, 3 panels or 3 columns. Okay. And the limit is that the maximum gonna be 12. Okay. Because that's the limitation on the bootstrap. Okay. Banana use the bootstrap, the grid system, so you can have a span maximum of 12 per row. Okay, so that's why. Okay. Okay. And each panel have a type. Okay, it's a very modular architecture. You can see that if you open up the source code, you know, in Banana directory and go to the panel folder, you can see that each folder gonna contain all the necessary code to run for that specific panel. Okay, so for terms panel, you have, you know, edata.html, module.html, and module.js. Okay, so that is the minimum requirement for you to have in order to build your own custom panel. Okay, so let's take a look at, you know, what each file does for the dashboard. Okay, the first one, edata.html, this one is gonna be used for rendering the the configuration of your panel. You know, you can see in the dashboard, right? If you take a look for the panel, you can see kind of like small gear icon here. It looks kind of like circle, but it's actually a gear. That is an editor panel. Okay. So whatever you put inside editor.html is gonna show up on that, you know, panel configuration UI. Okay, so that's gonna depend on what kind of a UI you try to build, right? For example, if you build a map, map panel, then when somebody click on the edit button, you may want to ask them to put something like, you know, latitude, longitude, you know, country, you know, something like that. Okay, so that way you can get those settings and send it to query with the Solr server. Okay, and the second file is the module.html. That one is used for rendering the UI, the actual display of the dashboard. Okay, so, you know, all the chart and stuff, bar chart, pie chart, you know, it's gonna render in module.html. And the last one is the meat of the panel, which is module.js. Okay, this one gonna contain the JavaScript code for all the business logic. Okay, the logic that you have to process, the query that the user gonna be feeding to the dashboard. You know, you can do some manipulation. You know, some filtering, like, you know, maybe you wanna add some numbers, for example, you know, different fields. So all those logic, you know, computation should be inside the module.js, okay? Okay, so yes, my presentation is very short because I try to show you the code walkthrough. Okay. So let's take a look. So quickly, so for those of you who haven't try the banana, this is what it looks like. Okay, so we have a dashboard, okay, and the way you configure your dashboard is in the dashboard setting. You can input your Solr server, okay, the URL into specific collection, and then the rest is just, you know, customizing each panel on the dashboard, you know, to do what you want to do, right? And you can do no, let's say you want to do drill down, right? You can just click on the bar chart, the pie chart, and the dashboard can refresh, okay, with an additional filter, as you can see here. So we have three condition, you know, three filter query for the whole dashboard, okay? And then the whole dashboard, each panel gonna re-render the data and display it again, okay? So it's, you know, it's pretty flexible, you know, pretty quick for someone to who want to try to visualize the data inside Solr. They don't need to learn, you know, the complex, you know, Solr query, you know, and they can get up to speed very quickly. Okay. Okay. So this is an example of the panel. Okay. I don't know what to name it. It's called dummy panel. Yeah. So this one is not part of the banana panel. Okay. It's just a quick panel that I put together for this presentation. Okay. So behind this one is actually d3.js. Okay, D3 is a popular library for making visualization. So let's see how we gonna be able to create it. Okay, so now, remember we need three files, right? So we need to have, okay, take a look, okay, cool. So you need to have one is the editor.html, two module.html, and then three module.js. Okay, so let's take a look at editor.html first, right? In this case, okay, one of the thing is that it's easy if you plan on building a custom panel, you know, I would suggest you try to look at existing code, especially for the hits panel, because that's the easiest. Hits panel, it just make a query to Solr server and then get the total count number of your num file, you know, the number of documented file, and then just display it on the dashboard. So that's very easy, you know, for you to get started to learn how to build your own custom dashboard, you know, and then develop into a more complex one. Okay, so this dummy panel actually based on the hits panel. Okay, so in editor.html, okay, usually you will ask the user to input, you know, like what is the field, maybe for faceting, for example, okay, and maybe, you know, how many, what is the number of rows you want to retrieve, you know, the result back from the Solr, okay. So in this case, I have two, right? I have two input that I ask for the user. So when we click on the gear icon here to configure the dummy panel, and go to the panel tab, okay. This is where the editor.html gonna show the result, which is this one, okay. In this case, I input the price and I want the number of results, just 10 results, you know, just for demo. Okay, click, okay. And next one is the module.html, which is the chart itself. In this case, it's gonna be the bar chart that I show in the dummy panel. Okay, you can see that this is gonna be kind of like a pattern, a template. First of all, you need to tell the code that, you know, the NG controller, you know, AngularJS, right, that is gonna be a dummy. This should be the same name as your custom panel, okay? You can put some styling in here, and then the code to render the actual panel, okay? In this case, I create an AngularJS directive, which is the recommended way to do it. Okay, so that's a pretty short one, okay, for the module.html. But the complexity can be in module.js because that's where the JavaScript code live. Okay, so let's go through it. Okay, so on the top, right, just as usual, you know, you import all the library that you need to do stuff in this code, right? And then you you will want to here, okay. Each panel gonna follow the same pattern like a dummy panel. In that, okay, the first one you want to do set some default properties for that panel. Again, depending on what kind of data you want to show, right? But in general, you're gonna have a default query that attached to that panel. You know, usually just a star, you know. And if you have anything else, you know, size, you know, or maybe even the color or something, you can just put it all here in the default property here. Then, it's gonna be, the next function is gonna be the getData. This is have to, this function is used for issuing the query to Solr server. Okay, so in the getData, right, okay, since we don't have much time, I might skip to like the important part. This getData, if you look, okay, for the top here, it's just constructing the usual Solr query, right? Filter queries and all the stuff, you know. And this one, you can, if you notice, is that it's not hardcore, but it's actually get the query, the filter query from the service, okay? Filter service, and also the query service, that two main services that we use in Banana. So that's why, you know, when you click on the bar chart and do the drill down, okay, all the panel reflect the correct data, you know, related to the drill down, okay, yep. So once you constructed all the query, right, you send the query or the request to Solr server, and then you will get back a result, okay. In this result, you will want to do, you know, the parsing, okay, parsing all the data, do the calculation, manipulation, you know, but in case of the his panel, it's easy, you don't do anything, you just grab the number and then display it, okay. But for me, in this case, for the dummy panel, I actually use a D3 CSV, okay, to pass the result, okay, and then I issue the query to Solr and get back the CSV result, so that's why I need to pass it as a CSV. If you issue the query to Solr and get back the JSON result, then you have to pass it differently, okay? Okay, now, okay, now if you notice, the last step is to actually render that result that you get back from Solr. And rendering is actually down here in the directive, okay, dummy short, right here. Okay, so you see that's the function for rendering the panel is right here. Okay, okay, I'm not gonna go into much detail, but it's just a D3 code, okay. So we go through each of the result that we get back from Solr, you know, in array, and plot each individual bar chart, okay. And then the styling, the color, you can also customize it. You know, you just have to put the setting in editor.html, or you just hard code it like I did in module.html right here. So for the demo, I just hard code the color to be still blue, and that's why you see the dashboard. The barcode is a blue color right here. Okay, so that's, you know, so is this very, you know, easy, customizable? And let's see. Also, okay, when you, after you're done with the dummy panel, you know, creating all the necessary file, right? Next step is that you have to go to the file called config.js, okay. If you download the Banana source code, right, it should be on the top root, you know, the very top level of the directory. In config.js, you have to add your custom panel, okay, into panel names array, okay, in order to activate it in Banana. Otherwise, you know, you won't be able to add your new panel. It's not gonna show up in Banana. Okay, so config.js is the file. Okay, so after you've done that, then you can, you know, click add panel here, you know, add a new panel, and then the dummy panel is gonna show up here. Okay, and then if you have the editor.html implemented, you know, to config, then it's gonna show up too. So you can, you know, type in, you know, all the necessary setting and then add panel, and then boom, okay, dummy panel show up. Okay, see, super easy, right? Yes. Cool. The room is very quiet. It makes me nervous. Anyway, so okay, actually that's okay. I think that's pretty much for all the talk here. But so next is that you guys might be interested in the roadmap of banana, especially the banana fan. Glad, you know, to be honest, you know, when I first working on the code, right, and when I never think that, you know, anybody on earth gonna use it. You know, I took one lesson of JavaScript from YouTube, and that's it. And that's how I got started, you know. And yeah, so so it's actually good to be here. This is my first conference for Solr since I started to work with for Lucidworks. So I'm really glad that, you know, people come up to me and asking questions, you know, criticizing, you know, both positive, negative. You know, I'm very welcome. So so about the roadmap for banana. Okay, someone came to me and asked me like why we fork from Kibana, you know. So what's the direction gonna be from now on for banana, you know, especially, you know, Kibana 4 just came out in beta. Okay, the answer is that we're gonna continue in our own path, because my main goal is to make banana fully compatible with all the Solr features. Okay, we want to make all the user, all the Solr user, you know, have like learning curve. Sorry, the learning curve. Okay, as low learning curve as possible. You know, because in, you know, issuing the query in Solr, you know, it's kind of, you know, not so easy for someone who never tried to use Solr before, right? But with the right tool, you know, I believe that we can empower the business user, you know, or someone new to Solr, you know, to quickly utilize, you know, become productive with the data they already have in their Solr implementation. Okay, so banana gonna go on our own direction. And also there's some of the cool feature, which is we already been working, you know, me and my team. So here too, Ahmed, okay, sitting in the front row. Thank you for your support. We actually prototyping by adding Node.js into banana right now. Because right now, right, it's just all client-side code, correct? So if we add Node.js, which is the server-side code, we can make it become like a complete application. Okay, now the cause issue, the cross-origin, you know, request gonna be gone because all the Solr requests gonna come through Node.js now. And we can do a better manipulation since now we have code on, you know, both on the client-side browser and on the more powerful on the server side. So we can do, you know, more cool stuff. Okay, and one of the very first thing that I plan to do is that I want to make it more user friendly. Yeah, a lot of people, you know, some, you know, see that, okay, may have trouble about, you know, try to get started with banana, you know. Although I think it's kind of like, you know, not really hard to use, but, you know, but we can improve on it. Okay, and once we finish the integration with Node.js, we can have, you know, different dashboard on the same panel. You know, we can have like a different tab, you know, different interaction, and actually we already have some integration with our partners like a Couchbase, okay, and some of the lookup. So we have data in Solr, and we can grab the field and the value and send it through the Couchbase API and grab, you know, more data from the Couchbase and display it on top of banana dashboard. Okay, so that's, you know, so that's a pretty good feature, especially if you already have an existing data in your own infrastructure that is not in Solr, and you want to integrate it, you know, quickly, right? So you can just install Solr banana on top, and then just configure banana dashboard to look up the data, you know, from whatever you want to do. Okay. Okay. That's a good timing. Still have about 5-6 minutes left. Anybody have a question? Yes. Yes. Okay. That's a good question. So the question is that on my panel, I have two dummy, is it going to use two separate query or one query? The answer is two separate queries. And that's also something that we also try to work on too, because some a few people, you know, asking about, you know, similar question about the optimization. Yes, and we are aware of it. So thank you. Yes.
So that means each of those panels is running a separate query? You're not sharing context?
Each panel running separate query? Yes, each panel. Oh, okay. Yes. So the filter, you mean right here, right?
Yeah.
Okay. In this case, actually, okay, I forget to talk about, like, if you take a look here. So there's two different type of data that in banana separate, which is the one you see here on the panel. Oh, okay. They warned me. Crap. Hey, dude. Oh, no. This is not the time. I pinged him 2 days ago that I'm here. He just replied me. Yeah, where are you now? Okay. Sorry. I'm so sorry. I thought I closed everything. anyway, we have a time series data and non-time series, right? So in this case, the dummy dashboard, right? The data here is a non-time series because I don't have a time figure here. So that's why there's no filter right now. So we can also filter through, you know, through the regular query, right? So, but let's say if you have a time series data, for example, the one from the Solr Unleashed class, right, you have a time span here, right? You can see that the filter, there will be three elements of the filters here. One is based on the field time, start time. One is based on the start station name, and one is on the birth year, right? So this filter is actually kind of like a, what do you call, like a token, I'm not sure if you use it right, but like a token, like a URL parameters. That's going to append, you know, to your Solr query, like a FQ, filter query, basically. Yes. And then all the panel going to issue separate query, you know, with the filter panel, the parameter attached to it.
So where does your dummy panel, how does your dummy panel get those filter parameters?
Oh, okay. Yes. Actually, I kind of skipped that part. Okay. So in module.js, right, the question is how does the dummy panel get all the filter parameters is actually, the magic is right here. It's in this part of the code, right? So, like I said, there's a two main services when you want to construct the Solr query. One is a filter service query. So when you call this function, you actually get all the filter that is active on the dashboard. Yes. Can you say that again?
Refresh the data.
Refresh?
On the dummy panel.
Okay. How?
Can you refresh the data on the dummy panel?
You can. Yes. But that means you have to implement the code into module.js to do that. Okay. Because if you take a look here, you can take a sample. I think. Hold on. I think I have. You can take a look at the time picker panel as an example. In time picker panel, they actually implement the auto refresh here, and you can specify, you know, how often you want to refresh the whole dashboard. Okay, but remember though, right now it's a single page application, right? So when you refresh something without saving your change to a JSON file, you're gonna lose that change. Yes, so. Save often. Yes. I learned my lesson quite a bit while working on the project. Yes. Okay, no more embarrassing pop-up. Right. Any more question? Okay. Right. Okay. Glad. Okay. So thank you for coming and listening to my talk. And if you have any question, you can just, you know, come catch me, you know, after word or send me an email. Okay. I'm always available. Okay. Thank you.